Hello, St. Peter's and friends. It's good to be back with you again. I hope you're all doing well with the continuation of our stay-at-home order. We're supposed to be getting warmer weather, and we had a little bit already this week, so a little taste of it. So I hope that we're getting a chance to get out. Even though we can't get out to see our friends and family really that much, just to get outside the house is nice. Although we are starting to open up things throughout the state, so slowly. It's not working out very well for our area, but hopefully soon we will. And I think when that happens, I might have to start shaving. So, but anyway, today is Friday, so you know what that means.
Puppy Bowl 11. Hello, everyone. I'm James Hound, and welcome to the Puppy Bowl 11 pregame show, where we will bring you all the stories and all the pregame action as we break down a matchup that is sure to be one for the ages.
Yep, we are doing our pregame for the this coming Sunday. We talk about one of the readings that is coming up. And so this reading this week is from Acts 17, and this is about when Paul is going to Athens to preach in Athens. And I'm not going to bother reading the whole thing, but I hope you get a chance to. It is Acts 17, 16 through 34. So this is one of my favorite scripture readings. For some reason, I can identify with Paul. I can picture this happening. It's like a movie in my head, so I think it's really cool, and that's why I think I like it. And I sort of become a fan of Paul's each time I hear the story. It's like he's some kind of biblical bad. Paul has been on his mission all over Macedonia, and he's gone from Philippi, where he was put in prison, to Thessalonica, where he wasn't well received. And then he went to a quick stop in Berea, which was going well until some of the Thessalonians came down and stirred up some trouble. The believers suggested that it might be a good idea for Paul to get out of town and for his own safety. And so they escort him to Athens to wait for Silas and Timothy, who stayed behind to continue preaching. So Paul is hanging out on his own in Athens. And verse 16 says he was deeply troubled by all the idols he saw throughout the city. The Greek word for troubled here is paroxysm, and that meaning it means sudden violent emotion. Paul wasn't only grieved, he was ticked off. So Paul's a little emotional here, and he wants to burst out with the word of God. But after everything he's gone through at the previous stops on his mission trip, he needs to take it slow, especially since he has no backup with him. Paul needs to play his cards right if he's going to reach the Athenians.
Every gambler knows that the secret to surviving is knowing what to throw away, knowing what to keep.
The Athenians were well-educated people, but they were ignorant of the one God. So Paul starts playing his hand slow by ministering to the Jews and the God-fearing Gentiles in the synagogue and speaking daily in the public square. And Paul knew that the people of Athens seemed to spend all their time discussing the latest ideas. He sees people start to take notice, so he ups his game a little. He's got them hooked. So they take him to the high council in the city. This is a place on a hill near the Acropolis. And Paul now has an audience of some of the best thinkers. But Paul is no slouch. He too is well educated, and he has been trained to present his beliefs clearly and persuasively. So Paul meets these people on their level. He doesn't start by giving a history lesson on the Jews. That would have meant nothing to them. Instead, he starts with the things they know. He began by building a case for the one true God by using an example they understood, by referring to the statue with the inscription to make his point. This unknown God was something that many cultures were aware of. They had these other gods, but it was commonly understood at some level that there was an unknown force that started everything, but they really had no understanding. So Paul explains, hey, this God you don't know, that has created all things, that has been out of reach, is now close at hand. And the time for worshiping things that are made of stone and metal is over. He's willing to overlook these transgressions, and this God now calls you to respond to him. Now Paul has them where he wants them, and he goes all in.
He's in! He's all in!
So he says this, for he has set a day of judging the world with justice by the man he has appointed, and he proved to everyone who this is by raising him from the dead.
Sorry. I live this way.
This concept of the resurrection was completely foreign to his audience. At this point, he lost most of them. It says here that some joined him and became believers. Among them was Dionysus and a woman named Demarius. I think these two are named because they were likely known in certain circles and would have served as witnesses to the events written here. Some scholars say that this was a failure for Paul, that he pulled out the resurrection card way too early. But others will say it was a success, that Paul had a limited time and the odds were against him. I would say that looking at the spread of Christianity in that region, it was a success. But just as important is, what do we learn from this passage? Well, I think first and foremost, we, like Paul, need to be prepared to share the gospel no matter what the circumstances. We do this by studying the Word of God. Secondly, we must be willing to meet people where they are. Take time to know them. Don't just turn the Bible hose on them. It's not always a matter of if we're going to tell people about Jesus. We should all be doing that. It's sometimes a matter of how we tell people about Jesus. I remember this one time many years ago. I was at the gas station filling up my vehicle, and when I heard this voice from behind me that asked, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? I paused for a minute, and then I slowly turned around, and I saw a well-dressed man filling his tank at the other pump on the other island. And I said, I'm sorry, are you talking to me? He said, once again, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Well, I said, yes, and then turned around and continued my task. At that time, I was a little put off by the question, even as a believer. Not the question itself, but the randomness in how it was presented. I can only imagine how put off someone who didn't believe might be. There's a familiar saying that people don't care what you know until they know that you care. And I think there may have been a number of folks in Athens that really didn't know how much Paul cared. So let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for your word that teaches us your will. Let your word dwell in our hearts so that we are always ready to share our faith with others. Heavenly Father, we pray for an end to this virus that has upset our daily lives. But as we deal with this new normal, let us make the best of our situations. Let us take this time to study your word, to grow our faith. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, thank you again for being with me, and I hope that you have a great weekend and enjoy some time worshiping via video this Sunday. Until next week, may the Lord give you peace.